A very good morning to one and all.
Morning.
Here at XLRI, we believe experiential learning is an important way of developing oneself. Towards this end, the leadership committee, through such events as today's, invites stalwarts and distinguished achievers from all walks of life to interact with students and help us in gaining a better and more informed perspective of life and business. On behalf of the leadership committee, I welcome everyone to today's much anticipated event. I now invite Amit Chaudhary to introduce and welcome our esteemed guest for today. Thank you.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. It is my pleasure to present to you Dr. Vijay Sharma. Dr. Sharma completed his B.Tech in Metallurgy from IIT Kharagpur in 1977. He then went on to complete his M.S. in Materials Engineering from Rensselaer Polytechnic Institute, New York, in 1980. My heart swells with pride to let you all know that Dr. Sharma is an XLRI alumnus of the class of 1984. It feels great to have you here, sir, and we are sure you would agree that studying at XLRI was one of the best things you did. Dr. Sharma's quest for knowledge culminated in a doctorate from Anna University in 2009. For over 36 years, Dr. Sharma has been a committed metallurgist. He has received awards such as National Metallurgist Award from the Ministry of Steels and Mines in 1988. He was also conferred with Eminent Engineer of the Year Award by the Institute of Engineers.
And thank you very much for this very elaborate introduction. I don't know whether I deserve it at all or not. Today I am going to speak to you on steel industry. Now, talk on steel industry can be very technical. But I am addressing the management students here, so I have not made the talk very technical, very simple, and when it comes to technicalities, but I have tried to bring to your notice the intricacies or the approach to steel manufacturing business which makes it in a humble way successful. And still since I am from steel background, I'll give you some insight on steel, so that there will be little bit extra knowledge on this subject after this presentation. Thank you very much for inviting me. I am thankful to Director Father Abraham to invite me for this presentation to the young management students of this institute. Well, as you know, iron and steel ranks amongst the most important materials of our times. The iron and steel industry remains viable and dynamic industry. Thanks to the creative engineers and enterprising investors, competition, the driving force of invention and innovation, has forced steel makers to adopt new technologies and reduce cost while maintaining quality. Steel production has shown increasing trend worldwide due to industrialization and infrastructure development, especially in the developing countries. Let us go back a little bit in history. Thank you. Up to 3500 BC, 3500 years before Christ, at that time also, human beings used 6 metals, namely gold, silver, copper, lead, and iron. I don't know about you, but being a metallurgist, I can't even imagine how during that time they would extract these metals and shape it and use them. So this engineering or this technology, this science is as old as that. Let's go a little bit forward. In the year 1800, the output of iron worldwide was less than 500,000 ton. And at that time it is guessed that the population was 900 million worldwide. So the consumption of iron in 1800 was 0.5 kg per man per year. By 1900, 100 years later, the steel production increased to 28.3 million tons. So in 100 years, it multiplied about 50-55 times of crude steel per annum. But by this time, it was known that iron and steel are the two metals which have enormous properties for various end applications. So 20th century really witnessed the crown wheel. This steel we made for companies like Ashok Leyland, NJ, EBGL and so on. There are suspension springs which goes into steel. These springs were earlier imported all from Japan. Now companies like NHK and SSS, these are Japanese companies which make these springs in India, and that for the raw material for these springs now are supplied from our company as well as some few other domestic companies as well. Picture which you see in the center, this one, this is the picture of the engine valve which we supply to Micro Bosch. A lot of steel we make for wire and wire ropes. And apart from steel business, as I told, Usha Martin is very big way in wire and wire ropes. I don't know how many of you know, but in wire ropes, Usha Martin has a very big name. And we are amongst the top 3 companies in the world with regard to production and marketing of wire ropes. These are some of the steels that we make for high tensile fasteners. And Sudar Fastener is one company which is the leading company in this country, Sterling Tools. And there are many other whom we supply. There are piston rods, goes to Gabriel, Indian Piston, Tata Hitachi, Hyundai, JCB, Caterpillar. The front axle beam for Tata Motors and Eicher Volvo. Crankshaft for Mahindra Forge. These are the forging companies whom we supply, but finally the steel goes to either Tata Motors or Mahindra and Mahindra Tractors and so on for the automobile ride. The stub axles goes to Tata Motors, Mahindra. Automotive gears, Halliburton, John Deere, Bharat Gears, Tata Motors, JCB. The camshaft goes for Brakes India, Tata Motors and other companies. Connecting rod in the engine, Mahindra, Mahindra and so on. Axles, International Tractors, Tata Motors. Timken bearings, we are the sole suppliers to Timken bearings in this country. So I just wanted to give you a flavor of what are different types of steels that we make in Usha Martin and supply for many end applications. At least about 10 years back, half of them were being made in this country with imported steel, which is now indigenized quite well. And in fact, India and China are going to become the auto component workshops for the world. And many companies are coming into India, opening their facilities for their supplies to European and American countries. Steel making is a capital intensive operation. Steel products are very expensive, and when they go to our forgers or any of our end application people, it is normally the cost of steel itself for them is between 60% to 80% of their total cost. So therefore, they have to have very reliable suppliers when it comes to special steels, because these OEMs, all these international companies, any field failures and all can be very, very serious and expensive. You must have read many times, so-and-so company called back so many lakhs of cars because this and this failed and so on and so forth. In steel, like any other business, to keep the business profitable on medium and long term basis, one must have a very good business model. If the business model is good, then it is possible to make the steel complex profitable on the medium and long term. It is very difficult to sustain the business if the business model itself is not very sound. For instance, in steel business, the nerve center is quality of the product and cost of production. In any other consumer business, the nerve center could be quality of the product and marketing.
My question to you is, what are the greenfield project challenges faced in India? For example, in Orissa, where many MOUs have been signed, but a very few company came up.
For the new companies, the challenges are really uphill, absolute uphill. Steel needs a lot of infrastructure. It requires land, it requires water, it requires power connections, high tension power connections. It requires railway sidings, it should be near the port. It requires mineral. It requires many more things. So the challenge which they are facing, first of all, they don't get land only. They want to take some land, but there is and the land which you have to take in steel has to be close to the raw material, otherwise the transportation costs are too high. And the raw material, unfortunately, are all in the jungles and the hills and so on. And that is, they are the people who are living in those places. They don't have any very high level of school education, so to say. So therefore, they don't want to give their land. And they are very innocent people. They don't know what progress will take place. If there is somebody to go and tell them what was Jamshedpur 100 years ago and what is it now, and show them themselves, maybe they will change their ideas. But there are a lot of people over there with vested interests who don't want that to happen. So many companies like POSCO, Vedanta, they are very big companies, profitable companies. I mean, if they come to India, they will change the whole scene of this steel industry and aluminium industry. But they are unable to get the land itself. And it's not like China. In China, you tell you want to make a steel plant over here and this is the investment. The DC, the equivalent to our DC, he has all the authority and power to give them land, power, gold, this, that, all approvals. And the plant will come up. Here, first of all, to get the land itself is a Herculean task, number one. Then to get the linkage of the mines or raw material, you can forget it. It will take 40 years, you will still not have it. So, I read one article, I mean, a year back or so. Our situation has now become such that the existing steel plants will expand.
for a new person to come and put up a steel plant and make it profitable and expand is very difficult. Our political system, I should not say, perhaps doesn't allow that. So that is the problem. So the existing ones will only expand. Many new people who have come with a lot of promises, they will get iron ore, they will get this, all those things are never given. And then when they are, those things are not given, they are not no longer profitable. And it is a capital intensive operation. You see? It is going into, say, in our small company, it is a 2.7 crore turnover. So in that kind of business, if you put 2,500 crore and get off 2,700 crore, then only it is profitable, no? If you put in 3,000 crore and get off 2,700, for how long anybody can pump in that kind of money? So, our rules, regulations, land issues, mineral, forest, all they are so difficult they have made now, that it is virtually impossible to get, to put up a new steel plant. I think it is virtually impossible. It is very pathetic, but that's the way the situation is. I mean, we went into banning the iron ore export, all coal gate scam and all that, and what millions of dollars of foreign exchange that we lost. And today, all this gas which you see in the foreign exchange is all because of that. And now even if they want to take the other view and to start all this, the whole situation has become so complicated that it can't start off. So, although I may be sounding a little negative, but then sometimes you feel whether you will do at all. I came back to this city after 21 years. In between I never came also. The area controlled by Tata Steel was looking more beautiful than before. The area which was not Tata, I am sorry to say, it was looking much worse than before. It is just a mindset. Either you improve with time or you go down the pipe. So environment sustainability is a very subject close to my heart, and we do a lot of things in that, but there is huge amount to be achieved there to some market. We hope that someday we will be at 5 leaves certificate. So that is a serious subject, very, very serious subject. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. That was really a very insightful and a very enriching experience. And thank you all for the lovely questions. Now, I would invite Amrit to give the word of thanks.
Hi all. On behalf of XLRI, we would like to thank you, sir, for visiting us and giving a valuable insight into the steel industry and responding to all our queries patiently. On behalf of leadership committee, I would like to thank our esteemed faculty, Professor Shantanu Gupta, for his presence and support. Finally, we thank our batchmates for their cooperation and participation.